I'm going to talk about the Hessian fly in wheat, past and future. And one thing I want to point out right early on is that I'm not an associate professor of functional genomics like it says on the flyer. I'm with the USDA ARS and I have an adjunct associate professor position. So I'm going to talk just a little bit about the history of the Hessian fly at Purdue. I'm going to try to introduce the Hessian fly community, a little bit about the Hessian fly wheat interactions, pest status of the Hessian fly in the southeastern United States where it's a real problem. I'm going to mention some work that Brandy's actually doing, combining two of the newer and very effective R genes, H25 and 26. And then I'm going to talk about a feeding assay that we have, and Christy Williams and I are working on this, to discover putative transgenes for resistance. And then I'm going to mention a little bit about another project that Brandy and I have in collaboration with Jeff Stewart. It's using pheromone traps and molecular markers to genotype virulence in field collections to the R genes in wheat. And then I'm going to mention the salivary secreted salivary gland proteins, these SSGPs. These are the effectors that elicit the symptoms in a susceptible plant, and many of them are the avirulence gene products. And actually, almost all of that work has been done by Ming Chen at K-State, but we have cloned and characterized one of the so-called common SSGPs. And I'm going to use that as a lead-in to RNA interference and the annotation of RNAi genes in the Hessian fly that a former grad student, Jacob Shreve, did. So the history of the Hessian fly at Purdue. Well, the first item I have is that the first experiment station bulletin printed in 1885 was on the Hessian fly. And it was compiled by Francis Webster, who was an agent with the USDA. He was sent to Purdue in 1884, and he was a consulting entomologist to the then Department of Horticulture and Entomology. And I have a little bit of, there we go, a little bit of the introduction there. And the bulletin is actually amazingly correct for the time period that it was written. And if you notice here, they understood that the Hessian fly does not produce true outgrowth galls. So it has these systemic effects in a susceptible plant, but it really doesn't produce a true gall. The other two people I want to talk about are Jim Hatchett and Bob Galoon. And Jim Hatchett and Bob Galoon made a lot of the very early contributions to our understanding of Hessian fly and wheat. And Bob Galoon got his PhD from Purdue in 1960. And his thesis dealt with the selection of four, as they were called then, races of the Hessian fly from an Indiana population. And Jim Hatchett got his PhD from Purdue in 1969, and his thesis project dealt with the genetic interaction between resistance in wheat and virulence in the insect. And from that study, this paper was published, and it's on the genetic interaction between resistance in wheat and virulence in the insect. And I copied a little bit of the abstract, and the most important part I've highlighted in red, and that is that the interaction between resistance in wheat and virulence in the insect is complementary, and it functions in a gene-for-gene manner, such that for each R gene in wheat, there's a complementary gene for survival in the insect, or you can also look at it as a complementary gene for avirulence in the insect. And that is kind of illustrated here with this little diagram. So R is a resistant plant, and the black box is the resistance gene product. And S is a susceptible plant and not carrying an R gene, so there is no R gene product. A is an avirulence gene, and the red triangle is the avirulence gene product. And on a resistant plant, the avirulence gene product is recognized by the R gene product and elicits a defense response, and you get an incompatible interaction. And mutations in the avirulence gene can result in a virulent genotype that avoids recognition by the R gene. And from Jeff's lab, two of the types of mutations that have resulted in virulent genotypes, with one of the virulence genes, VH13, the mutations are insertions, and there are three different size insertions, as I will show you later. With VH9, the mutation is a point mutation and a transport motif, so presumably the gene product will not get into the host cells, and the genotype avoids recognition. So this is the current Hessian fly community. Here I am. I work basically mostly with the insect side. Christy Williams works with the plant side. Brandy is a population geneticist. Jeff is the insect geneticist in the department, and I want to point out that basically without a lot of the work from Jeff's lab, the Hessian fly would not be the model organism it is today. Sue Cameron is our support scientist. She runs the greenhouses, the growth chambers, does all the testing for resistance with lines from public and private breeders. Ming Chen is ARS at K-State. He's done most of the work with the salivary glands effectors, and he also has done a lot of work on the plant side. And Marion Harris has done a lot of work on the basic biology of the fly and also on the ultrastructural changes and responses in the plant in both susceptible and resistant wheats. Well, the Hessian fly life cycle is shown here. And there's a female there laying eggs that you can see here on the surface of the leaf. These eggs will hatch in about 3 to 4 days. The larvae crawl down into the leaf sheath, down to the base of the plant, and these are early first instar red larvae. And all the damage to wheat is done by the feeding from these first instars. After about 6 days, the first instars molt to a second instar seen here, and the second instar feeds for about half of its developmental period, and it stops feeding. It molts to a third instar that is contained within a puparium called a flaxseed. And in a fall infestation, the third instars will overwinter in the flaxseed, and the adults will emerge in the spring to repeat a spring infestation cycle. The effects of Hessian fly infestation are shown here. The plant on the left is resistant, growing normally. The one on the right is susceptible. And in susceptible plants, there's a reprogramming of the plant that results in the irreversible stunting. And in particular, you can see the third leaf here is stunted, and this dark green color that you see. Also, there's an induction of susceptibility, which I will get into later, and suppression of basal defense responses. There are rapid changes in host cell permeability, and also the formation of a nutritive tissue to feed the developing larvae. And this is an example of Hessian fly damage in a field situation. This is obviously from Mississippi County, Missouri, and the picture was taken in 2005. And this field was seeded with two varieties of wheat. The one on the right here was a pioneer line. It was very early maturing and great for double cropping, but it did not carry an effective R gene. And as you can see here, there are a lot of bare spots. That's where Hessian flies actually killed plants, and the rest of the plants, primary shoots and tillers, are all stunted, and stunted primary shoots and tillers will never flower. And this half of the field is basically just a complete loss. The left half of the field was seeded with a Virginia Tech wheat line that was carrying an effective R gene. And as you can see, these seedling plants are developing normally, and this side will be unaffected. Whoops, what did I do? There. Okay, well, the formation of the nutritive tissue layer, this is EM work that was done by Marion Harris. And on the right there is a normal cell, and this is a nutritive cell. And the changes in the nutritive tissue begin very rapidly, about 2 days after larvae attack a susceptible plant. The nuclei and nutritive cells become diffuse, and there's an increase in the number of vacuoles that you can see there. The epidermal walls thin and rupture, leaking nutrient-rich cytoplasm onto the leaf surface, and also between epidermal cells. So you can see leaking here onto the surface and between epidermal cells. And eventually the mesophyll cells are affected, and cytoplasm leaks from the mesophyll cells into the epidermal cells, and larvae are no longer feeding on individual cells, but on a nutritive tissue comprised of many cells. The induction of susceptibility in wheat is through a susceptibility gene called MDS1, or Mantle Destructor Susceptibility 1. And this gene was identified in Ming's lab at K-State in 2010. And susceptibility genes are genes that are manipulated by a pathogen or parasite and are essential to susceptibility. And various different S genes have been identified since 2002. And these are some examples of them in Arabidopsis and rice. And the first one was a pectate lice in Arabidopsis, and then you can see some of the others here. And in Hessian fly, the susceptibility gene is a small heat shock protein that larvae affect that gene, and the transcript levels go up tremendously. I think in some of Christie's array experiments, it's like a 100-fold increase over uninfested plants. And so the way Ming found this was basically through a microarray analysis. He saw a small heat shock gene whose transcript levels were upregulated tremendously in the compatible interaction. And when the expression of the MDS1 gene in susceptible plants was knocked down by VIGS, so VIGS is a type of RNAi done in plants using a viral vector that will express basically small interfering RNAs. And Ming also used transgenics to knock out the susceptibility gene. And when he did that, the plants became resistant. So he was doing this with normally a susceptible line of wheat. But when he knocked down or knocked out or silenced the susceptibility gene, the plants became resistant. And then when the MDS1 gene was overexpressed in resistant plants, again through transgenics, and the plant was Molly carrying H13, the plants became susceptible. And so he has continued to work on this, and there may be other susceptibility genes in wheat. Within the induction of resistance, on a resistant wheat, larvae fail to induce susceptibility. And so that's one of the key steps in resistance. Larvae don't induce susceptibility, but they do induce upregulation of a defense response genes. And some of these genes are genes that encode lectin or lectin-like proteins, and that work has come out of Christie's lab. PR genes, both Christie's lab and Ming's lab, and then also genes involved in reactive oxygen species. And one of the first indications that reactive oxygen species might be involved in the defense response was through the work of my former PhD student, Umprakash Mittipalli, who is now a faculty member over at Ohio State. And what Umprakash did was look at the expression of various antioxidant defense genes in larvae on resistant plants, and he saw that their expression was upregulated compared to susceptible plants. And at the time, it was kind of thought that maybe there was not a classical oxidative burst associated with the defense response of wheat to Hessian fly. And so there was some question about the validity of this study. But about 3 years later, in a collaboration between Christie's lab and Ming's lab, it was confirmed that reactive oxygen species are involved in the defense response. And with some R genes, that response is greater than with others. And Ming has also cloned one of the R genes. It's HDIC. And the function of HDIC as an R gene, again, was confirmed by VIGS and transgenics. And it encodes one of these nucleotide binding site leucine-rich repeat proteins. And these types of R genes are frequently involved in hypersensitive defense responses. Well, the pest status of the Hessian fly in southeastern United States. So that's where a Hessian fly is a persistent problem and causes yield losses that can be equivalent to those caused by major pathogens, as you see here. And one of the reasons, and the most successful control strategy for Hessian fly for Hessian fly in the southeast is genetic resistance with R genes. However, the deployment of these R genes results in a selection pressure and an increase in the frequency of genotypes that can eventually overcome the deployed R genes. And in most of the southeast, there is no fly-free date. That's a date where you plant after a frost would have killed the adult flies, but you still have enough time for the wheat seedling wheat plants to develop enough to overwinter. So in the southeast, you can be collecting Hessian flies on pheromone traps in January, February, and March. And they can be 6 to 8 generations per year. And of course, with that number of generations, that will increase the rate at which virulent genotypes increase in response to our gene deployment. And this is a chart that was compiled by David Button from University of Georgia. And it shows the change in biotype or genotype composition in Georgia over a 14-year period. So in 86, the predominant genotype was E, or biotype as they used to call it, E. And E only has virulence to one of the R genes, H3. But by the year 2000, this purple bar here indicates biotype L. And biotype L can survive on H3, 5, 6, H7, 8. And it, of the original 16 biotypes that were defined by basically these four R genes, it is the most virulent. And this is a study that Sue Cameron did in 2010. And what Sue did was evaluate 21 of the 33 R genes with collections across the southeastern United States. And at that time, she could really only get seed for 21 of the 33 named R genes. And so basically the take-home message here is that only those genes that are highlighted in blue would provide the best protection. And so even though there are 33 R genes and probably more that can be identified, the native R genes are not a finite source of resistance. And so that emphasizes the need for alternative strategies for the deployment of R genes and also the development of transgenic resistance if genetic resistance is to remain, in particular, a viable control for Hessian fly in the southeast. So I'm going to talk a little bit about some work that's actually being done by Brandy because I found that she's somehow is not going to be giving one of these presentations. So what Brandy has done, or an alternative strategy for deployment of R genes as single genes, is in combinations or pyramids. And two of the previously undeployed and very effective R genes from Sue's study are H25, it came from rye, and H26 from Aegilopitaceae. And this is a Gish picture showing the location of the interstitial translocation from rye on the long arm of chromosome 4A. And these are the microsatellite flanking codominant markers that have been used to integrate H25 in with H26. And there. And this is the location of H26. H26 is on the long arm of 3D in a bin along with H32 and H24. And these are the markers, codominant flanking markers for 26. And so Brandy has F2 seed now from F1 plants carrying both 25 and 26. And that seed will be planted in the agronomy farm. And they'll be, taking leaf samples to extract DNA from the plants. The plants are going to segregate. 1/16 will carry two copies of 25 and 26. 1/16 won't have the R genes. And the remaining plants will be segregating in various ways for the two R genes. And so she hopes to have a germplasm line is carrying both 25 and 26. And she is also making a combination of 9 and 13. And she has both plans for both experimental designs with studies with these gene combinations, as well as their use in an applied manner. And that's some work on implanted translocation feeding assay that Christine and I have been working on. And there are various anti-nutrient and toxic proteins that have potential for transgenic resistance in wheat. However, Hessian fly is an obligate parasite of wheat, and attempts in the past to develop an artificial diet to make such proteins accessible for consumption have not been successful. And what we've done is developed a simple implanted translocation feeding assay that allows these proteins to be ingested by Hessian fly larvae. And we've used this assay to provide an initial assessment of the effects of various anti-nutrient and toxic proteins on Hessian fly larvae. And this is the setup of the feeding assay. So plants are infested with gravid females under a cup cover, and after the eggs have hatched, the plants are removed from the pot and from the soil. The soil is washed away, and we cut the roots approximately a centimeter from the base of the plant. And this is just a mock-up of how the assay is run. We would normally have more replicates than that. And we had a water control here, and BSA is our control protein. And how this assay works is, this is susceptible Newton, and this plant was infested, and I can't see it, but there's actually a larva still here, and the dye is neutral red. And this was 3 days after infestation, and you can see this massive change in permeability. And this is due to the reprogramming of the plant by the larvae. What I showed with the formation of the nutritive tissue. And it's this increase in permeability that is associated with making the proteins that are being translocated up into the plant accessible to the larvae. And this protocol is actually used back in the mid-80s, around 86 first. And at that time, we used a dye called Nile Blue Sulfate that has a hydrophobic and a hydrophilic end. And if it's ingested, in fact, it's been used to trace, I think, feeding through termite colonies. And if it's ingested, it accumulates in the fat body. And this is a very old slide, and the pictures aren't very good, but you can see the blue stained fat bodies in three of the larvae that came off of a plant. And we used the assay at that time to evaluate the Bowman-Bierk inhibitor. And we had published a paper where we showed that BBI was very effective in blocking the digestive proteinases, serine proteinases, in the midgut of the Hessian fly. But when we used the assay, absolutely nothing happened to the larvae. And so we thought that perhaps the larvae would ingest the Nile Blue Sulfate, but the larger protein, maybe they just weren't getting it. So when we decided to go back to the assay a little over a year ago, one of the first things Shuba did was do Westerns to see if indeed the larvae were ingesting the various proteins that we were feeding them. And WGA is wheat germ agglutinin, soybean agglutinin, Galanthus nivalis or snowdrop lectin, and BSA is our control protein. And as you can see, there are signals with each of the lectins. There's also a main signal with BSA, and it looks like the BSA is being digested, whereas the lectins are not being digested. And that's kind of characteristic of lectins. They're refractory to proteolytic degradation. So this is a box plot, and really the take-home message here is we tested a number, more than 9 actually proteins. But of all the ones we tested, Galanthus nivalis agglutinin or snowdrop lectin was the most efficacious. And again, here with BBI, it had no effect, which is was surprising to me. It's a very potent inhibitor in vitro, but when fed to the larvae, it does absolutely nothing to retard their growth and development. And this is the effects of ingesting GNA on the development of 7-day-old larvae. So we have here water control, BSA controls. In fact, sometimes the BSA controls are a little bit larger, but it's not statistically significant compared to the water controls. And these are the GNA treated larvae. And this dark structure in the middle here, that's the midgut. And if you look at these two larvae, they were still in the latter part of the first instar, and they were showing some movement. But these other two larvae, you can't see the midgut like you do in these, and we think those were actually dead. And this is the effects of ingestion of GNA on the midgut epithelial cells. So A is a water control, B is a larva from the BSA control, and sometimes actually the microvilli look denser on larvae that were ingesting BSA. And C through H are different, are midgut sections from different larvae that had been ingesting GNA. And so you can see microvilli are just drastically disrupted. There are these large vacuoles that show up in some of the cells, and these electron-dense particles that really show up in some of the epithelial cells. And so GNA has a dramatic effect on the midgut, which often a lot of lectins do. And we've quantified approximately how much DNA individual larvae might take up by Westerns. And again, this is what Shuba did. So in lanes 1 through 5, those are standards. Lane 6 is an extract from 5 larvae. So the larvae ingesting GNA are really small, and you don't, you can't detect GNA in an extract from an individual larvae. But in this this particular assay, by a scan, it was the signal there indicated about 9.6 nanograms. And so with these assays, it's about 2 to 5 nanograms is what individual larvae are ingesting of GNA. And we also have a chimeric construct for resistance. And an additional property of GNA is its ability to cross the gut barrier and enter the hemocoel, with some insects anyway. And that has been used to use it as a carrier protein to transport fused toxic proteins into the hemocoel with insecticidal effects not shown by GNA or the toxic protein alone. And we, in a collaboration with John Gatehouse, we have received a clone for such a chimeric construct expressing a fusion protein of GNA and an insect specific neurotoxin called buta-IT. And this is the this is basically the chimeric construct. So the orange here is the GNA leader sequence, the blue is the buta-IT toxin, and the green is the remainder of the GNA sequence. And this construct has been inserted into a vector for transformation of wheat by Harold Trick at K-State, and he has some T0 plants that are positive for this particular construct. And we hope to, okay, so what we would be getting back are T1 seed. But there's quite a process to go, the T1 plants will be segregating. So what you have to do is select a line that would be stably expressing the GNA buta-IT fusion protein. And that in itself is quite a long process. And we hope to get that and evaluate it for GNA buta-IT fusion protein for resistance to Hessian fly, green bug, Russian wheat aphid, and wheat stem sawfly. So we would be doing the evaluation with Hessian fly, while green bug and Russian wheat aphid would probably be done at K-State and Oklahoma State, and the wheat stem sawfly probably at North Dakota State. Well, we've also worked with some BT toxins with Hessian fly, and we've received a number of strains of BT from Brian Federici at Riverside, as well as strains of Bacillus sphericus that produce mosquitocidal proteins. And we have also have a collaboration with Mary Ann Carey at Case Western Reserve, and she does a lot of the purification. We don't have the protein expertise to do the purifications of these crytoxins. And she's going to purify some of the crytoxins from some, the strains that Brian Federici has provided, as well as, as well as these crytoxins that she has in-house. And however, using a re-engineered strain of Bacillus thuringiensis israeliensis supplied by Brian Federici, which expresses only the Cry11A toxin. So there's several toxins actually in BTI, in the toxic crystal of BTI. And he has re-engineered a strain that only produces in its crystal the Cry11A. And this applies to both the crytoxins as well as the other toxins. Our goal is to have transgenes for resistance basically under the control of Hessian fly responsive promoters that allow site-specific expression at the feeding site of a larva instead of expression throughout the plant. So with like SmartStack and the various BT corns, the expression there is ubiquitous throughout the plant. And we don't want that. We want to have expression just where, in the case of Hessian fly, the larvae are feeding. And one way to do that is through Hessian fly responsive promoters that would allow for that. And that's one of the things that Christy's working on, and she has some of these promoters cloned and they're testing them. And this is the effects of Cry11A on Hessian fly larvae. So this is an SDS page. Again, it was a fairly crude solubilized protein fraction, but this heavy band here, that's at 72 kD, that's the Cry11A toxin, And this is basically a Western validating that the cryo-11A toxin was in the protein fraction. And again, the effects with the cryo-11A are very similar to what we saw with GNA. So here's some larvae, as you can see, the midgut, and then there are other larvae that looks like basically the midgut is disrupted, and it's possible that those larvae are basically dead or dying. Well, the other thing I want to talk about is a study that Brandy and I have in collaboration with Jeff Stewart. And what we're doing is using pheromone traps and molecular markers to genotype flies for virulence to resistance gene H13. And this protocol can be used with basically virulence to all of the R genes as Jeff clones the genes for virulence. And these are the female baited pheromone traps in fields in Alabama. This is an adult male. So the males come into these female pheromone baited traps. And these are the collection sites in North Carolina, South Carolina, Georgia, and Alabama, collected primarily back, I think, in 2010. And Alicia is the one. She takes the inserts, washes the flies off of the sticky insert, and then scores, keys them out for being Hessian fly, extracts the DNA from them, and uses diagnostic PCR-based diagnostic markers that were designed in Jeff's lab to reveal if the male was virulent or avirulent. So as I said, so there are three, with VH13, there are three alleles for virulence, differing in size with these imperfect repeats that you see here. And for virulence, there are also three alleles, at least in the United States, in the southeastern United States, and their virulence is due to insertions of various sizes. And this is a gel. So this was an AVR1 control here, individual, and this is a VIR1 control. And these are the amplicons. And then the next set of amplicons here are from individual males off of a trap. And so you can see this individual is VIR1. And this one was VIR2, which is a little bit smaller. And then this one right here, this is AVR2. Which is a little bit smaller. And then this is VIR2 right here, which is a little bit smaller than VIR1. And this is a partial table showing the frequency of the AVR and VIR alleles in various collections, and also the percentage numbers. And so the advantage here is it's much easier to put pheromone traps out in fields and get them back than have people go out and sample for living flies off of wheat plants. In other words, dig up wheat plants. Plus, this also gives you a direct measure of the frequency of virulence and avirulence in the field populations, whereas a test like the flat test that Sue does just tells you that a certain proportion of the plants evaluated were either resistant or susceptible. And you can monitor with this approach the changes in the frequency of virulence with deployment of a particular R gene or a combination of R genes. Well, the next thing I want to talk about are the secreted salivary gland proteins. And again, this is almost all work done by Ming at K-State. And he classifies these secreted salivary gland proteins into three types: small, large, and common. And so this is the elementary tract of a Hessian fly larva that was dissected out. This is a malpighian tubule. This is a malpighian tubule. This is actually the hind gut coming off the midgut. And these are the salivary glands, and this is the foregut. And these basal cells here are the cells that produce these salivary effectors. And this is the filamentous region of the salivary glands, and it's polyploid, while the cells in the basal region are polytene. So there's a very large number of these small SSGPs, and they have an unconventional conservation in that the 5' and 3' untranslated regions and the introns are more conserved than the coding region. And Ming has several theories as to why that is. And some of them are thought to be the effectors, eliciting the systemic responses and a compatible interaction, and some are known to be the virulence genes because of Jeff cloning these. And however, their function in the compatible interaction is basically unknown. And some have this RXLR motif that is also found in pathogenic oomycetes. And with the common secreted proteins, those are usually include like enzymes and also some inhibitors. But we've actually cloned and characterized one of the common SSGPs, and it's a secreted salivary lipase from the salivary glands. And both Hessian fly and the Asian rice gall midge, another gall midge that's a major pest of rice in southern Asia, have a salivary lipase like this. And this is the cDNA sequence. We also have the genomic sequence. This is the deduced amino acid sequence. And this is the signal peptide in red. And if you were to blast the protein sequence, you'll find that it has all the necessary domains to be a lipase. And you get a lot of really significant hits to various venom phospholipases from wasps and bumblebees. And this is the expression of the lipase in the salivary glands. And this is the chromosomal location on the long arm of autosome 1. So why are we interested in a secreted salivary lipase? Well, you've seen this picture right here. This is obviously a reprogramming of the plant. But on a resistant plant, these yellow arrows pointing out basically dying red larvae, 3 days old. And if you look, you can see that there's these little red dots here and here. And it's hypothesized that that is where the larvae tried to probe an epidermal cell. And as a result of that, there's a change in permeability with those, a very localized change in permeability with those cells. Well, and as the plant develops, this will basically, these wounds will be healed. So this is not associated with reprogramming like you see over here. And we hypothesize that a salivary lipase could be involved in an initial attack by larvae of an individual epidermal cell. And this is an EM image from Marion Harris, a study looking at resistant wheat. And if you look here, this is presumably one of these wounds that is generated on a resistant plant. And the other interesting thing is that you can see the wound doesn't go through, does not span the cell wall. That's because the mandibular stylets of the larvae are too small to actually span the cell wall. So again, we hypothesize that a lipase could assist in getting some of the SSGPs into that initial epidermal cell. So to test this, it would be nice to have some sort of functional genomics. And that brings me to RNAi. So this is a little cartoon from Ambion, and it shows a very abbreviated schematic of the RNAi pathway. So in C. elegans, there's a single dicer. But in insects, there are two dicers. A dicer 1 that functions in the microRNA pathway, and a dicer 2 that functions in the small interfering RNA pathway. And also in insects, dicer 2 is assisted in the production of small interfering RNAs by another protein called R2D2. Some creative naming of some of these genes and proteins. But anyway, the small interfering RNAs associate with the risk complex. You can, right here. Whoops, where did it go? Yeah, here, right here, risk complex. And basically, the small interfering RNAs unwind and an activated risk complex with association with another protein called Argonaut2 is targeted to a message by the antisense small interfering RNA, and Argonaut is an endoribonuclease, and it cleaves and degrades the target message. So ever since the discovery that double-stranded RNA can silence genes, RNAi has emerged as a very powerful tool for functional genomics. However, with Hessian fly, we've had limited success. And actually with Drosophila, which is one of the leading models, it also does not show a robust systemic RNA response like Tribolium does. So I've tried to summarize here the two classes of small RNAs that I will be primarily talking about. There are several classes of small RNAs besides the small interfering and the micros, but I really won't be discussing those. So small interfering RNAs are processed from an exogenous double-stranded RNA in insects by Dicer-2 and R2D2. And this is a small RNA, double-stranded RNA that would be processed. And the RNAi pathway is not there for us to do functional genomics. It was there to defend the genome from invasive double-stranded RNAs or RNA viruses. And again, the small interfering RNAs assemble into a RISC complex to degrade a targeted mRNA, and RNAi with small interfering RNAs can be used for functional genomics. MicroRNAs are processed from an endogenously expressed hairpin double-stranded RNA by DOSHA, PASHA, and Dicer-1. And this is a pre-microRNA. And they function in transcriptional regulation, post-transcriptional regulation of a gene expressed gene expression. And in plants, the target mRNA is degraded, while in animals, generally, the target translation of the targeted mRNA is inhibited. However, in some cases, if you get a perfect match between the microRNA and the target message, even in animals, the target RNA will be degraded. And there are three different types of RNAi, particularly with small interfering RNAs. There's the cell autonomous type, and there a double-stranded RNA is either expressed or introduced into a single cell, and you get an RNAi response that is autonomous to that single cell. Another type is called environmental RNA, and there double-stranded RNAs in the environment are taken up by cells, and an RNAi response is elicited in those cells that have taken up the double-stranded RNA. The third type is called systemic. And there, a single RNA, double-stranded RNA molecule can be introduced into a cell, and then it is systemically, the effect is systemically propagated through the surrounding cells and also to other tissues. And it's this type of RNAi response that Tribolium elicits. So when our former grad student, Jacob Shreve, one of his studies was to annotate basically the RNAi and microRNA pathway genes in Hessian fly. And these are the core genes for the miRNA pathway. And so here's DROSHA, Dicer-1, PASHA, Locetius, and Argonaut-1. And Argonaut-1 is also an endonuclease, and in plants it would cleave the target message, but in animals, generally, the RISC complex just inhibits translation. And these are the genes involved in Hessian fly in the small interfering pathway. So there's Dicer-2, R2D2, C3PO, which is also an endonuclease, and Argonaut-2, which is an endonuclease. In peewee, AUB and AGO3 basically function in other translational silencing mechanisms. And one thing to point out here in this box plot, there's greater conservation among all the genes in the microRNA pathway compared to the small interfering RNA pathway. And that's in particular, you can see that with Dicer-2 compared to Dicer-1. And then these are genes involved in either the spread of RNAi, the systemic spread, or the uptake of double-stranded RNA, and that were annotated out of Hessian fly. So in C. elegans, there are two genes encoding proteins that are transmembrane proteins called systemic interference defective genes. And mutations in these resulted in a defect in the systemic response in C. elegans. So SID2 is involved in the systemic initial uptake from the environment of a double-stranded RNA, while SID1 in C. elegans is involved in propagating systemically the RNAi response. And SID1 has been identified in Tribolium, Bombyx mori, Apis mellifera, other LEPs, and quite a few aphids. It has not, no SID has been identified in either Hessian fly, Drosophila, and Anopheles. These insects would not be able to elicit the kind of systemic RNAi response that you would see in Tribolium or even honeybee or silkworm, et cetera. And Drosophila lacks that. However, Drosophila S2 embryonic cells do have an environmental RNAi response. And the double-stranded RNA are taken up by endocytosis, and these are genes that are involved in that process. And these are the annotations that Jacob did in Hessian fly. So it is possible that an embryonic cell line from Hessian fly could elicit an environmental RNAi response. It's also possible that if you injected, in particular, let's say, small interfering RNAs into the hemoseal or injected into embryos pre-blastoderm, that you might be able to elicit an environmental RNAi response. And then these classes of genes down here are involved or are hypothesized to be involved in a systemic spread, something like what occurs with the SID genes in C. elegans. So these are the approaches that we've used for delivery of double-stranded RNA in Hessian fly. And the first one is injection into embryos pre-blastoderm. So this is an embryo that was injected, and you can see the blastoderm just barely here. This embryo, the little red dots, it's a syncytium of nuclei, and the blastoderm has not formed. And this is a larva from an embryo that Wei Lin, when Barry Pithenry was here, he did these injections, injected with a lot of blue food coloring, and the larva is blue, so you can get a lot of stuff in. Well, another approach, and this has been used in Jeff's lab, is soaking larvae in double-stranded RNA or small, this was always done with double-stranded RNA. And we've injected with both double-stranded and small interfering RNAs. And this is an experiment that Alicia did. And so she soaked the larvae with Nile blue sulfate. And if you look at this larva, it looks like the larva has the blue dye in it. But a lot of the other, you'd have to stretch your imagination. So at least in our hands, this was very inconsistent. Some larvae would have the blue dye, others did not. And so Jeff has had an experiment where he did soaking, and they got basically a knockout of VH13 and a change to avirulence to H13 and a change to virulence. But it's been very difficult for him to reproduce that. And so maybe that's part of the problem here, is an inconsistency in the soaking approach. And we've also had a couple of cases where we thought we saw an RNAi effect. And this is one of them. So what we were doing is trying to silence a particular SSGP that Alicia works on, and we call it 4A. And here we injected embryos with small interfering RNAs for 4A. And then we infested plants with individual larvae. So here's a control, and these are control plants, and you can see the third leaf here is stunted. And then these are the experimental plants with larvae from embryos injected with small interfering RNAs. And actually there's a larva down here. And this is the third leaf here on these two plants. And as you can see, the third leaf is significantly longer than in the controls. And that's shown in this chart over here. And also it's kind of hard to see, but the larvae are significantly smaller than the controls, and that's shown here. So we thought we were seeing possibly an RNAi effect. But when we went to reproduce this with double-stranded RNA, nothing happened. And then with Wei Lin's help, we had another experiment. And here we injected into pupae. And we have a putative orthologue of a Drosophila white. It's an ABC transporter. And we tried to silence that in pupae before pigmentation of the eyes. And so these are some pupae that were injected. And in particular with this one, if you look right there, you can see there's a reduction in pigmentation compared to the controls. And in this case, we actually looked at transcript levels. And these are from the controls, some of the control individuals, and these are some of the ones injected. And there's a lot of variability in transcript levels, but the transcript levels are knocked down in varying degrees in the larvae injected with small interfering RNAs. And this is the mean expression. And the transcript level was significantly lower in the larvae that had been injected. So, and again, when we tried to repeat this with double-stranded RNA, nothing happened. So we wanted to take, from Jacob's work, we wanted to take a little closer look at the Dicer-2s, Dicer-2 orthologs. And these are procyte scans of Dicer-2 orthologs from Tribolium, Anopheles, Drosophila, and Hessian fly. And so there are two RNase-3 domains. There's a double-stranded RNA binding domain, which amazingly, it looks like Tribolium doesn't have that. Maybe that's just an annotation error. There's a Dicer domain, and then there are these helicase domains. Well, the PAWS domain, it stands for Pee Wee Argonaut Zewili, is involved in setting the size of the small interfering RNA that's going to be processed from the exogenous double-stranded RNA. And if you look at the proportion of the PAWS domain that it occupies relative to the Tribolium Dicer, it's 17.2%. It's 10.1% with Anopheles, but with Drosophila and Hessian fly, it's only 8.7%. And these are some trees here that I generated quickly, and they're kind of hard to see, but I use C. elegans Dicer as the outgroup. And this is the Dicer-1 clade here. This is the Dicer-2 clade. And the main thing to take home is the branches are shorter here. And that's because overall, Dicer-2s are more conserved than the Dicer-1s are more conserved than the Dicer-2s in the four species here that Jacob was looking at. And we've also, these are bootstrap values all support the topology of the tree. I also made a tree dendrogram, and this is the method here is distance neighbor joining, with just the PAWS domains, again with C. elegans PAWS as the outgroup. And because the number of informative characters goes down because of the small size of the domains, not all of the bootstrap values are significant. But again, the topology, the PAWS Dicer-2 domains are all in one clade, and the Dicer-1 PAWS are in another clade. Again, the branches are shorter because the PAWS domains in Dicer-1 are more conserved. And Hessian fly falls out with Anopheles. And that's because basically there's a greater level of identity at the amino acid level between Anopheles and Hessian fly than Hessian fly and Drosophila. However, both Drosophila and Hessian fly appear to have truncated PAWS domains. And so we hypothesize that truncation may be result in a reduced efficacy of the Dicer-2 orthologs in these species. And perhaps this is why we had better success with small interfering RNAs versus double-stranded RNAs in our experiments. And this is kind of redundant, but it's the Dicer-1 proscans. And again, the main thing is that overall, the sequence similarity between the Dicer-1 orthologs is greater than between the Dicer-2s. And C. elegans is the most divergent. And actually, helicase domain and the Dicer domain overlap in C. elegans. And it appears that in Anopheles, Drosophila, and Hessian fly, the N-terminal helicase ATP binding subdomain is missing, or that maybe that's an annotation error. We're not sure right now. So in summary, Hessian fly is a model organism for galling insects. It is the most important insect pest in the southeastern United States, often causing yield losses equivalent to those incurred from pathogens. We're combining or pyramiding effective R genes to enhance the durability of resistance. A feeding assay has been developed to deliver anti-nutrient and toxic proteins. And we're using this assay to discover potential transgenes and for resistance. And we want to express those in a site-specific manner with Hessian fly-responsive promoters. We're using pheromone traps and molecular markers to make field collections and genotype flies for virulence to R genes in wheat. To date, the Hessian fly does not appear to have a robust RNAi response, but we may have gotten discouraged a little too soon, and we want to go back and maybe look a little bit more at that and see if we can't get a better result. And Hessian fly genome sequence is being used to facilitate cloning of virulence genes and also to enhance basic knowledge concerning the Hessian fly biology and its interaction with wheat. And that's basically what I have.